Kick off today's and invite Naveen Chugh, who is the founder and CEO of the Chugh Corp. Naveen is a multi-talented individual. I have known him for many years, as many of us have. He is a highly accomplished attorney as well as an accountant, a CPA, and he advises people on multiple areas. But one thing that many people might not know about Naveen is, as serious as he has an immense knowledge about the history of how things actually evolved in the United States. Whether you look at demography, whether you look at entrepreneurship, whether you look at the Indian diaspora and how they have been able to create a huge move in terms of entrepreneurship and creating large companies, or if you talk about how a certain policy impacts future thinking for us, whether we are thinking about it as the state of California or the United States or the entire globe itself. Naveen was very instrumental in creating TAI in Southern California. He's a very active member of TAI, one of our charter members, and I'd like to invite him on the dais and let him take it away. Thank you, Naveen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Difficult to compete with Apple's press conference, right? God knows what they're up to, a watch or Apple iPhone 6 or competition to PayPal. But congratulations to all the innovation winners, and thank you, Lockheed, for doing this event. I want to take you back a few years. Maybe let's go back 400 years. You know, there is a big misconception in the United States and the rest of the world that Christopher Columbus discovered America. We even have a Columbus Day. And if you went to any middle school in the United States right now and asked the students who discovered America, maybe 85% of them would say Christopher Columbus. And the truth is, Columbus never made it to the United States. And if Google was around when Christopher Columbus set out in 1492 and he had GPS, I guess he would be making the right turn at the bottom of Cape Town, Africa, and not making a left turn. And if he had done that, then none of us would be sitting here. So it is great he made a mistake and ended up in the United States. In actuality, human beings first stepped into the United States 15,000 years ago through Siberia and through Alaska and Canada and the United States. And so U.S. is not 500 years old as the majority of the country thinks, but at least 15,000 years ago. But what was happening from 15,000 years ago to maybe 1600, 400 years ago? And let's look at the world in 1600. And 1600, for many reasons, if you're a fan of history, is a very important year. A lot of stuff happened. It was a turning point for many things. So 1600, today, as you know, the population of the world is 7.3 billion. 1600, it was 545 million. And 125 million people in India, 190 million people in China, and 5 million people in the United States. And that 5 million in the United States was soon to die. They didn't know back then, but 90% of that 5 million would vanish in the next 100 years or so, as the Europeans came to the United States and along with them brought diseases that decimated 90% of the whole Indian population that existed in the United States. So much so that if you go from 1600 to 1777, when the U.S. got independence from England, 177 years had gone by, and the population of the United States in 1777 was 2.6 million people. They've gone from 5 million to half, and never mind the increase in population for the last 177 years prior to the independence. So we go from 5 million people in 1600, 90% of them dead in the next 100 years, and add the increase for 177 years, and we end up with 2.64 million people in 1777 when U.S. got independence. But back to 1600, 5 million people, what was in the United States? It was empty, it was new, it was fresh, it was clean, and filled with natural resources. And if you think about, you know, how God makes certain parts of the planet, U.S. was blessed from day one, even though it was empty and there were very few people. But plenty of flat land, plenty of mountains, plenty of rivers, and abundance of natural resources. As a matter of fact, U.S. doesn't need to ever import anything to self-sustain itself. One of the very few countries that can say that. And naturally protected. Very few countries in the world have Atlantic Ocean on one side and Pacific Ocean, and the two largest oceans in the world, as a buffer. So U.S. couldn't be attacked, invaded, decimated, World War I, World War II. Nobody could attack the United States. The only country that tried to attack the United States was Japan, and all they could get to is Hawaii. They couldn't cross Pacific Ocean. And with the result that U.S. was never attacked or invaded, and the U.S., of course, participated in both world wars, but at its own choice, and Europe requesting it to participate. So here's one of the most wonderful land spaces in the world, huge, three times the size of India, 3.6 million square miles as compared to India's 1.2. Huge, massive resources, protected by Canada on the in the north, which is sparsely populated, and India as the population of Canada every 2 years. That's how little the population of Canada is. And most of Canada, you can't live there because it's too cold. And Mexico to the south, but buffered by Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. And along with oceans comes protein, right? Of the seafood that's sort of free. 17 quadrillion gallons of water in the Atlantic Ocean, and 35 quadrillion gallons of water in the Pacific Ocean. And if you're wondering what a quadrillion is, and if you've forgotten, and all of you are smart people, so I'm kind of stupid to even say it, but for the heck of it, a quadrillion is 1,000 billion, a trillion, and 1,000 trillion, a quadrillion. That's how much access to water U.S. has had and continues to. And this water and this Atlantic and Pacific Ocean buffer on both sides of the United States is one of the reasons why U.S. became the super dominant power in the world, because United States, while World War I and World War II were happening, and in between realized that one way to control the world is to control the waters. No ship anywhere in the world can move from destination A through B without U.S.'s approval. And if U.S. wants to interject, they do, and they can. And that's part of the strategy, that let's control the waters. Airspace is hard to control. No country can say, well, I control the airspace. But water, U.S. controls. As a matter of fact, in World War II, when England asked the United States to help and borrowed money to buy bombs from the United States, this is where U.S. gets so good, right? Thanks to Lockheed Martin of the world. So England says to Lockheed, can you give us some bombs? And U.S. says, where's the money? And UK says, you don't have money. So U.S. says, fine, we'll loan you the money. So U.S. loans the money. But in bargain, U.S. said, okay, give us control of all of the water that you have under your power, all of the naval bases around the world you have, especially in the Pacific Ocean, surrender those to us. And UK did. So that's the advantage of the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. So what happens now that we're in 1600 and there's 5 million people in the United States? Most of them American Indians. You want to care to guess how many non-American Indians in the United States in 1600? How many Europeans? Any guess? Out of the 5 million? 5%. How much?
5%.
5%. Okay. 5% of 5 million would be 250,000. And remember that the ships were pretty much invented in the late 1400s, and there was no ship that could actually travel the Atlantic Ocean. And in 1600, believe it or not, 5 million people in the United States, 350 people of European descent in the United States. But the world was about to change. And as the ships got bigger and stronger and people could travel from Europe, and Europe was the only place where that one had the wealth to make ships and was close enough to the United States that people could come here. And from 1600 onwards, the immigration starts. Life started 350,000 years ago when a black woman gave birth to a baby. Every country is a land of immigration, if you look at it from that point of view. But most countries stopped immigrating people and welcoming people about 150 years ago, but the U.S. never stopped. So hundreds of thousands of Europeans start coming to the United States, starting in 1600. As the ships got bigger and better, and crises of Europe happened, every time there was a crisis in Europe, people would come to the United States. And people were not happy with the church in England, so a lot of people who were upset left. Now, this is very important. What kind of person in Europe gets up one morning and says, you know what, I'm not happy with my life here. Even though I'm getting food, even though I'm getting water, even though my life is somewhat okay, I'm not happy. I want to go somewhere. What kind of person gets up in the morning and says that? And then what kind of person packs up all of their life belongings in one suitcase or two? And what kind of person gathers money to get a ticket on the ship? And what kind of person says, even though the statistics are that every ship that left Europe in the 1600s and came to the United States, half of the people were dead by the time the ship landed or docked in the United States and the bodies overthrown. And what kind of person says, 50% chance I'm going to die, but what the heck? Let me go to a country that I never heard of. Let me go to a country that I know nothing about. Let me go to a country that I don't really have a map. I haven't seen a picture. But let me go. What kind of person does that? Crazy. The same kind of person that is packing his or her suitcases in Bangalore right now and taking a flight to the United States tomorrow morning. Same kind of person. An immigrant. An entrepreneur. As if willing to let go of what they have, willing to go to another country and start all over again, and risk dying if that's what one has to do. But they want to go somewhere better.
Dominating him, the brother, and has very little chance of moving up in the chain. So he leaves.
True. Somebody who's not happy with status quo, and somebody who believes deep down that, hey, I can do better than this. And I can, doesn't matter, I'm going to die. I'm going to end up there with $10 or $100 or $400, whatever, I'll manage. So, here's what happened to these immigrants that came to the United States. And there's a famous saying that I thought that the streets of New York were paved with gold, and then I arrive in New York and I find out that the streets are not paved with gold. And then I find out that there are no streets either. There's no streets, let alone paved with gold. And then the worst news of them all, I'm expected to pave those streets. That's what ended up with most immigrants. So 400 years people have been coming to the United States. The first 300 years, from 1600 to 1900, it was pretty much Europeans. To give you a glimpse, from 1840 to 1920, 80 years, 500,000 people from Europe moved to the United States every year. Whether it was World War I or the potato famine or whatever crisis was going on. On an average, 500,000 people a year, 80 years, 40 million. This 40 million people formed foundation of the United States, right? So that we see today. White Anglo-Saxon Protestants, not Catholics as much, but the Protestants that were rebelling against the church. And this 80 million, and of course their kids and the generation thereafter is the bulk of the United States. And all of that about to change as well. The next 100 years, other countries, as the ships got stronger and as when the planes started, is when the immigration started from the non-European countries. So, I'm sure most of you read or heard of Jim Collins' book, Good to Great. And Jim Collins in that book writes that forget interviewing people when you're looking for people to hire. Forget their education, forget their experience, whether it's relevant or not. Just hire good people and put the good people on the bus. And don't worry about where the bus is going. The good people will figure it out. Just hire good people. And in our firm as well, I keep saying to my staff, I don't care if we have need for this person or not. If this person is smart, if this person is good, hire him. We'll figure it out. I was interviewing one person, randomly showed up at our office, and a couple of people, other people interviewed her, and I said, how is she? And they said, I think good. I said, okay, let me interview her for 2 minutes. In 2 minutes, I found out that she's from Philippines. In 2 minutes, I found out that she stood seventh in the bar exam in Philippines. I said, okay, the interview's over, we hired her. Last week, a month ago, I saw a resume, a Pakistani kid born in the United States, and lawyer doing whatever, young guy, no work experience. And on his resume, I see that his parents have a 7-Eleven, a liquor store, a restaurant, and a gas station. And since age 9, he's been helping his parents. I said, end of story. I don't want to interview this kid. Hire him. Anybody who started to work at age 9, I don't care what they were doing, you hire them. Because they've seen it all. They know what revenue is. I don't need to tell them what payroll is. I don't need to tell them that you gotta work 40 hours. I don't need to tell them what hard work means. Anyway, so Jim Collins says, hire good people and put them on a bus and let them figure it out. They'll figure it out. Wells Fargo, a dying bank ages ago, the new management comes in, and that's what they do. Hire a bunch of good people, and now it's one of the most profitable banks in the United States. Beat Bank of America, beat all these other banks, and stocks gone from $9 to $50 in the last 4 years. So now it's 1600, fast forward to 1820. From 1840 to 1920, 40 million Europeans have come. And what kind of people have come to the United States? And as we briefly discussed, what kind of person packs up their bags and gives up whatever crappy life they have or a decent life they have and willing to move, a risk taker, an immigrant, an entrepreneur. Now United States, a land of abundant natural resources, the bus of United States is filled with good people. Nobody interviewed these people. There was no checklist, there was no interview, there was no resume, there was no job application form. There was nobody interviewing anybody at Ellis Island, at Statue of Liberty. Whoever landed there, however they came, was admitted to the United States. There was no immigration law, there was no H-1 visa, no nothing. If you could make it to the shores of the United States, you were welcome. The only way to come was off of the East Coast from Europe. You survived a 3 month boat trip. But the United States now filled with good people. Rebellious because they were not happy with the church. Rebellious because they were part of the Protestant community. And think of the word Protestant, these people were protesting all their life. So what happens to this bus filled with good people? Let's see what happens. 1750, Benjamin Franklin discovers electricity. 1876, Alexander Graham Bell invents the phone. 1879, Thomas Edison discovers or invents the light bulb. 1903, the Wright brothers take off in a plane. 1920, Ed Hubble discovers that Milky Way is not the only galaxy in the world. There's several hundred others. Till 1920, nobody in the world knew that. And he discovered that the space or the galaxies are still expanding. All of scientific life changed after that. 1960, Department of Defense, United States, invents the internet. 1969, America lands on the moon. Of course, when Indians hear that, you've heard the Indian line, right? Oh, when America landed on the moon, the Indians were already there. And the Indians fight, the Punjabis say that the first Indian there was a Sardar, who had a gas station and a dhaba. And the Gujaratis say, no, it was a Gujarati and there was a motel with a Pav Bhaji station. And the Hyderabadis say, no, there was an IT company. And have you ever met a Hyderabadi person with just one business? Every single Hyderabadi person I meet has two businesses, an IT company and a biryani point or a paradise biryani, right? So 1973, IBM invents a personal computer down the street from here in Los Gatos. 1975, Microsoft is founded. 1998, Google. 2004, Facebook. And 2007, Apple invents the iPhone, the first iPhone. This is what happens when in an area filled with natural resources, very little restrictions, no red tape, no bureaucracy, aggressive people who are going to protest. No matter what, because they've been protesting all their life. They protested against Europe, they protested against England. You put a bunch of them in the United States and nothing was gonna stop them. And this is what happens to this bus. Now, there is a saying that America was not discovered, that it was built by five people. And if you ever get any free time in life, read about these five people. And think about what was going on in the United States, that these five people built this country. Five individuals, not the government, not the state government, not the districts or the counties or the cities, not the federal government. Five people built America. And in the 1800s, late 1800s, between 1850 to 1920, these five people built America. And all five became either the richest person in the world or the second or the third or the fourth or fifth richest person in the world while they were alive at their height. Who are these five people? Andrew Carnegie, number one. Built Carnegie Steel, which became US Steel. And his company, built 75% of the steel of the United States. And in 1901, he sold Carnegie Steel to J.P. Morgan for $485 million. His share of that was about $300 million. And in today's dollars, Bill Gates is worth $70 billion and Warren Buffett's worth $50, $60. And Carlos Slim's worth $65 billion as well. But in today's dollars, when Andrew Carnegie sold Carnegie Steel, a private company, to J.P. Morgan, his share was $300 million, which in today's dollars, and by the way, it made him the richest person in the world at that time. In today's dollars, that's $300 billion. And Bill Gates is only worth 70 today. And in the years 1901, Andrew Carnegie had $300 billion. And he gave away 94% of it in charity for various causes, including 3,000 libraries around the world. Second person who built America, Cornelius Vanderbilt, who started with shipping and moved on to railroads. And just imagine, where else would this happen? This man owned 50% of the railroads of America. And I don't mean railroads as engines and compartments, I mean the actual physical railroad track and the land where the track was, 50%. All the way from New York to Chicago, the eastern United States, he owned most of it. Collectively, 50% of the railroad of America. One person, not the government,
not the British government that laid the railroad tracks in India, not the Indian government that manages to fix it. But one person, of course, became the richest person in the world.
What's his name, sir?
Cornelius Vanderbilt. And thanks to Andrew Carnegie, all five of these people gave away most of their money to charity. But Andrew Carnegie started it by writing an essay called The Gospel of Wealth, which I highly recommend that you read before you die. That in the year 1890 or so, here's a human being writing, and Bill Gates and Warren Buffett till today follow what's in that essay. And Andrew Carnegie wrote in 1890 or so that it is criminal for a rich person to die and give their wealth to their kids. And he said, he had one daughter, and he said, I'm not going to leave more than a few million to my daughter. And he ended up leaving 6% of the 300 million to her and gave away the rest of it. And all of these people, there are universities named after them. Carnegie Mellon is Andrew Carnegie's donation of first $200,000 to start the Carnegie Institute of Technology. And you've heard of Vanderbilt University, which Cornelius built or donated money. The next person who built America is John D. Rockefeller, the founder of Standard Oil. Now, these five had something going in their favor that no person can do today. There was no antitrust laws in the United States. So if Andrew Carnegie with his money could buy another steel company next door, and then when another steel company got big and threatened him, he could buy them and could control 75% of the steel of the United States. You can't do that anymore, thanks to the antitrust laws that happened in the early 1900s. So these guys had a free reign. It was a free country. They had to build it all. It was empty. Remember, it was new and fresh and clean and empty. There was nothing going on. And because it's 1,200 miles from north to south and 3,000 miles from east to west, the entire country had to be built. And in building it, these guys got very, very wealthy. And the government didn't stop them. The government tried to in the late 1800s and failed. And it took the government 50 years to get their act together and said, okay, no more monopolies, we're not gonna put up with this anymore. Several presidents tried it, and these presidents were bought. These five people would get together at times and collect money and elect the presidents because they could. They had so much wealth, and they knew what was gonna happen if the president was not of their choice. So they got away with murder, which nobody can do today, but they did it. The next person is John D. Rockefeller, the founder of Standard Oil, which was broken up by the United States government, and Standard Oil is no more. What's left of Standard Oil is Exxon. And these companies, when they were broken up, they figured out that, okay, fine, we've broken up, we'll start all over again. And Exxon keeps getting bigger and bigger by doing acquisitions. John D. Rockefeller, at his height, the richest person in the world, he had control of 90% of the petrol and the gas and the gasoline of the United States. The next person who built America was J.P. Morgan, a banker, a financier, a Wall Street whiz, and he helped the development of the United States. He financed the development of the United States. And we talk about M&A transactions now. Your company is getting more than M&A transactions. But this kid, J.P. Morgan, was doing massive M&A transactions and roll-ups in late 1800s and early 1900s. For instance, he went to Andrew Carnegie and bought Carnegie Steel for $485 million, which is an untold amount of money. Would be like $500 billion today. And bought a bunch of other steel companies and rolled them up and took the company public, which is what is U.S. Steel now. So Carnegie Steel was one of the several steel companies J.P. Morgan bought and amalgamated and rolled up and did U.S. Steel. He also did that with General Electric. That's how powerful J.P. Morgan was.
and founded what is left now of J.P. Morgan Bank, J.P. Morgan Chase, and the Morgan Trust, Morgan Stanley, the investment banking firm. All of these are leftovers from the J.P. Morgan house, which the United States government ordered break up in the early 1900s. The next person who built them, the fifth person who built the United States, is Henry Ford. Although he wasn't the first one to make autos, he was the first one to make them cheap. And what I admire the most about Henry Ford is him saying in 1920 or so to his managers that we need to give our employees a 400% raise in 1 month. And the managers are like, are you crazy? Why would we do that? And where is the money going to come from? And why are we giving everybody a 400% raise? And the answer, you will never forget the rest of your life. The answer was, folks, we're making this Model T car, which, by the way, Ford was making one every 10 seconds in 1923. We're making these Model T cars, but our employees cannot afford to buy one. What are we doing? We're selling these cars, but we're not paying our employees that they can buy a car. Let's give them a raise so that they can buy a car. And look at, we talk about the greatness of America in 2014, but look at 1929. 23 million households in the United States. Population of 120 million. 23 million households. And guess in 1929, and guess how many cars in the United States? 23 million. Almost every household in America in 1929 had a car. And so, as the world starts shrinking, the Indians hear about America and we couldn't come here on ships, and as the world starts to shrink, Indians start to arrive in the United States. In 1948 was the first intercontinental flight out of India. Air India flew a jet from Mumbai to London. And then in 1960, Air India flew the first flight to the United States from Mumbai to London to New York. The first Indians to arrive in the United States is the year 1900 on ships from Hong Kong, the British connection. And the first Indians to arrive were Sikh farmers to California and state of Washington and Oregon. And the Indian immigration started. And then it was put an end to in 1917. Congress in 1917, partly due to World War I, and a two-thirds majority against the wishes of the President of the United States, passed a law that no Asians would be allowed in the United States. And India was included. 1917. 1923, Sikh guy Bhagat Singh Thind files a case. And the case goes all the way to Supreme Court. And Bhagat Singh says in his filings that I'm not Asian, that I'm Caucasian and I'm white, and I'm of the Aryan race, so I can't be excluded from this ban on Asians. And the Supreme Court in 1923 rules that, okay, well, maybe you're right, but what Congress meant in 1917, that you have to be white, and white, the definition of white is people of Europe. So sorry, you're excluded. So no immigration from 1917 to 1946. 1946, finally, President Truman got around to convincing Congress to let Asians come and let Indians come back to the United States. And partly because World War II was happening and U.S. had asked England to help. They were all part of the same team. And England was asking Indians in India to help England and the United States fight Japan,
because Japan had gotten to Burma and was threatening to come to the to India. And so Harry Truman said to Congress that, wait a minute, we're expecting these Indians to fight for us in India, but we're not letting them into the United States, so that's not fair. So let's overturn the 1917 rule, and it was. So from 1946 to 1965, 7,000 Indians entered the United States. There was a quota of 100 per year, and of course there were exceptions to that. But there was no means. How could Indians leave India and come to the United States? They had to get on a plane. And you can just imagine how expensive it must have been from 1946 to 1965 to buy a plane ticket and go to the United States. In 1965, things changed. There was a massive immigration act because the European immigration had stopped. Remember, from 1840 to 1925, 100,000 a year, 40 million people over the 80 years. And then World War I happened and World War II happened, and there was all kinds of chaos in Europe. And millions of people had died in Europe. So the emigration to the United States had literally come to a halt. And US was now ready to accept non-Europeans. And non-Europeans had found out about the United States thanks to the world shrinking, thanks to airplanes. So 1965, there was this massive immigration act that said, okay, we will let families come, we'll let Asians come, and if you're a professional, and if you're a doctor or an engineer, if you land, if you enter the United States, you'll give you a green card. So as you roam around the United States, it's very rare to find an Indian in the United States that entered the United States prior to 1965. Either they're dead or there were so few. So the majority of the Indian immigration happened after 1965, first with doctors and engineers that landed and got a green card in the late 60s and all through 70s. This IIT engineers and the doctor immigration carried on to the point where IITs have graduated about 150,000 engineers in their life, and about a quarter of them are in the United States. So, and then of course the immigration carried on with the technology workers in the late 1980s and all through 1990s. And the last 14 years that you all know about. So, first Indian to arrive in the United States in the year 1900, a few Indians till 1917, about 5,000, out of which 75% of them were kicked out post-1917. They were not allowed to buy land. Then no Indian immigration till 1946. Then 46 through 65, 7,000 Indians, and then the real Indian immigration starts in 1965. So we've been coming to this country for the last 50 years, pretty much. So Europeans have been coming for the last 400 years. We've been coming for the last 50. And it's very important why I'm emphasizing on that, because look at where we have come in these 50 years. Look at where we are today. From literally population, Indian population 1965 of zero to 3 million, 1% of the United States. Exactly 1%. 3.18 million. 1% of the United States. 1 out of 100 people in the United States is in India. It seems more like that because there's Indians in concentration in California, and especially in the Bay Area, New Jersey, and New York, and Connecticut, and Atlanta, and Chicago. 85% of these 3 million Indians live in 12 metros, 4 in the east, 4 in the west, 4 in the center. So there's cities like Fremont and Sunnyvale where Fremont is 15% Indian, so 1 out of 7 people. So if you walk around Fremont, every 7th person is going to be an Indian. But look at where we've come in these 50 years. Look at where we are today. 3 million Indians. 71% of these Indians have a college degree, as compared to 28% of all of America. Three times, almost. 40% of these Indians have either a master's degree or a postgraduate degree or a professional degree, as compared to 8% of all of America. Average
household income of an Indian household in America, 100,000. Rest of the country, 50,000. Half. What are the 3 million Indians doing? And these are Mota Hisab rounded off numbers. 150,000 doctors. 1 out of 10. 10% of the physicians in the United States doctors. 25,000 dentists. 10,000 lawyers. 50,000 people have a small business in the United States. 500,000 software engineers. Or in IT in some shape or form. About 100 college deans, including the dean of business school at Harvard. 100 college deans. So here's our deal, right? We're 1% of America, but politically we're ahead. We have two governors out of 50 states, Nikki Haley of South Carolina and Bobby Jindal of Louisiana. That's 4%. We don't have anybody in the Senate. And we have one congressperson, Amy Barron from Sacramento. And 7 CEOs of the Fortune 500 in the United States. 7 of them are Indian. Satya Nadella of Microsoft, Ajay Pal Banga of MasterCard, Mehrotra of SanDisk down the street, Dinesh Paliwal in Chicago, CEO of Harman. Musical Instruments, the CEO is Indian. Francisco D'Souza of Cognizant, Indra Nui of Pepsi, and Abhay Talwalkar, again down the street, CEO of LSI. 7 of the top 500 Fortune 500 CEOs. And of course, we've lost 2 who are no longer CEOs, but they're very powerful. Ramani Iyer of Hartford, one of the largest insurance companies in the world in Connecticut. And of course, Vikram Pandit of Citibank. So, back to Jim Collins's bus. Fill the bus with good people and they'll figure it out. And have 40,000 Indian IT engineers in the United States and 500,000 software engineers in the United States. And they'll figure it out. And they have. Entrepreneurship, as you know, is sitting in the heart of the entrepreneurship capital of the world. And if you look at entrepreneurship centers around the world, like Silicon Valley, like Bangalore, there's a few things in common. 42% of people in Bangalore are from outside of Bangalore. Guess what the number is in Silicon Valley? 42% of the people in Silicon Valley were born outside the United States. Lots of good schools around. All of the entrepreneurship centers in the world, lots of good schools around. People, again, not only have packed their bags and moved to another country, now they've moved, packed their bags again and moved to another part of the world where they're generally younger, don't have obligations at home, and in the evening after work, they can go to Starbucks or a bar and talk about business and talk about ideas. Younger population, educated, very well educated, and access to capital. And again, aggression, again, risk-taking. So imagine what kind of people came to the United States now, double it up, and imagine what kind of people come to Silicon Valley. Probably one of the first true entrepreneurs of Indian race in the United States was Amar Bose in Boston of Acoustics. You've all heard of Bose speakers. First entrepreneur in Silicon Valley was Narendra Kapani of Fiber Optics in San Francisco, and Arun Netravelli at Bell Labs in the East Coast. And then, of course, the second wave of entrepreneurs started in Silicon Valley with Kanwal Rekhi at Novell and Sohas Patel at Cirrus Logic, and Vinod Dhamer and Chalan Vinod Khosla at Sun, and Pradeep Sindhu at Juniper Network, and Padmashri Warrior at Motorola and Cisco, and a gang of 4 at Google, Amit Singhal, and Sundar Pichai, and Nikesh Arora, and Vikram Vittor, all 4. Amit Singhal was employee number 22 or so at Google. So here's the deal. Given what has happened in the past with regards to Indian entrepreneurship in the United States and Silicon Valley, we've seen nothing yet. We just arrived in the last 20, 30, 40 years. And it took the Europeans from 1600 to 1850 for these five people to build America. So what is in the future of India and America? Back to the year 1600, I want to tell you and share with you the most my favorite graph in the world. And I encourage all of you to Google it and see this graph. In the year 1600, as I said, the world population was 545 million. India was 125 and China was 190 and US was 5 million. What about the GDP of the world? 1600. Guess what's the richest country in the world? China and India. 25% of the world GDP, India, 25% of the world GDP, China. And guess what is US portion of the GDP of the world in the year 1600? Zero. Nothing going on in the United States. Some farms. Guess who's the richest country in the world in 1650? India and China. In 1700, India and China. 25% of the world GDP, India, 25% of the world GDP, China, 1750, same drama, and then nothing happened in 1750, and the slide starts. India goes in 1750 from 25% to 2.4% in 1991, a drop of 90% in 241 years. And China goes from 25% to 6% in the year 1978, up to 50% in 20-30 years. And so Google this chart of GDP of the world 1500 onwards and see this chart of the last 500 years. It is just amazing. India, the richest country in the world, from 1500 to 1750. And nothing much has changed. Except for India, China, and United States. The rest of the world was always at 25%. Europe was always at 25%. India and China go from 50% to 10%, and US goes from 0 to 30% in the year 2000. So, the good news is that we hit the dip in 1991. And the good news is we're making the climb back up. The issue is, how long before? And you know, the world, it takes, like they say, that Bhagwan ki ghar mein deh hai andher nahi. It's just a matter of time. And look forward to this chart 500 years from now. Look at this chart in the last 500 years and think of what the chart will look like the next 500 years. And my guess is water finds its level and the world is flattening, and thanks to Google, to the world, every single poor person in the world has as much information as the richest person in the world. And goods are going to be free pretty much throughout the rest of the world, thanks to China and Walmart. So the issue is, my guess is, if all goes well, India is 17% of the world's population right now. So we will have 17% of the world GDP. Every country in the world, roughly in 500 years, will have the same GDP as the number of people in that country. US has 5% of the world's population, but it's sitting on 30% of the world's GDP. And every year, that number is going down. And we don't need for the world to, we don't need for the United States to get poorer, for India to get richer. It is not a zero-sum game. Remember, the world GDP was $0, literally, in the year 1600. It's $680 trillion of wealth that got created without anybody getting poor. So your role, your goal, the innovators of India, is we will get to 17% of the world GDP. The issue is, can you do it faster? Can we get out of this poverty and illiteracy faster? It's happening right now, and we're all sitting in this room, sitting inside a tower, all instruments to make this happen faster. Thanks to all of us. Thanks to Thai. Thanks to Silicon Valley. Thanks to the Indians doing well in the United States. Last year, Indians sent $70 billion to India from the United States. Personal transfer of wealth, personal money, and $80 billion of IT industry as they transfer between Infosys and the rest of the world. So the Indians that are doing well in the United States are helping India, and we will get to 17% of the world GDP. The issue is, can they accelerate? And I'll end with the future of the United States, the Indians in future of the United States. And this is very, very, very exciting. We're 1% of the United States now. If you look at demographics of the United States for the next 50 years, right now the Hispanic population is 1 out of 6 people in the United States. 1 out of 6 people in the United States is a Hispanic. Fast forward 50 years, it's going to become half. The second Spanish invasion of the United States is going to happen. The first one happened 400 years ago. The second is happening right now. 50% of the United States will be Mexican in 50 years. It's 1 out of 6. The Hispanic population, they're mostly Catholics, so they want to have more kids, and they start early. And by the time a white woman in America has a child, the Hispanic one's working on her third one. They get married in school, and teenage pregnancies, and literacy is not of high respect in that community yet. It'll change. The African Americans are 14% of the United States, and they remain 14% of the United States. The white population is diminishing rapidly, maybe down to 15% in 100 years. The true minority. Last year was the first time in the United States, first time, that more than 50% of the kids born in the United States were non-white. So, and look at who's going to school, and look at who's getting educated, and look at who can speak English, and look at what kind of person is United States made for. United States is education, entertainment, religion, and politics, and democracy. Sounds familiar? Indians, education, entertainment, religion, politics. Same drama. This country is made for us. The first studio, film studio, opened in Bollywood in 1910. They played a movie about Queen Elizabeth. Guess what year did the first movie studio open in Hollywood? 1910. Guess who makes the most number of movies in the world? India. Guess who's number 2 or 3? United States. So the point being, who? Now add all of this together. Look at this bus, Jim Collins bus filled in the United States. Look who's in the bus right now, and take this forward 50 years. And now tell me, 50 years from now, who is going to be the most richest, most educated, most progressive, most forward-looking community in the United States? The Indians. The corridors of power are journalism, movies, TV, university professors, deans, Wall Street, finance, management people, senior management of Fortune 500. And Indians are preferred over all other ethnic minorities afterwards. And my friend Neel Kashkari is running for governor of California. He's a kid born in the United States. My other friend, Kamala Harris, is Attorney General of California. And Neel Kashkari is running for governor this year, and he's going to lose to Jerry Brown. 4 years from now, Kamala Harris, who's half Indian, and Neel Kashkari, and Neel Kashkari is Republican and Kamala Harris is Democrat, they're going to run against each other in California for governor. Two Indians. So I'll end with this bet, that I'm willing to bet my life that in the next 50 years, we will see an Indian as president of the United States. Thank you.